From London, England, extracting the signal from the noise, it's theCUBE, covering Discover 2015. Brought to you by Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. Now your hosts, John Furrier and Dave Vellante.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We are here live in London, England for HPE Discover, special presentation of theCUBE, SiliconANGLE's flagship program. We go out to the events and extract the signal from the noise. I'm John Furrier, my co-host Dave Vellante. Our next guest is Manoj Nair, VP of Product Management, Convergent Infrastructure, and Roger Egan, SVP of Sales at Docker. Really pumped to see you guys. Good to see you again, Manoj.
Yeah.
And Docker, great to see you. DockerCon was phenomenal in San Francisco.
Yeah.
You guys just came back from DockerCon in Barcelona. Congratulations.
Yep. Thank you.
Great to have you on theCUBE.
It's great to be here.
Great to see you here at HP too, because this is, the HP is very cool and relevant. Docker's cool.
Yep.
And relevant.
Yep.
DevOps is the featured headline concept here as part of their new composable, so great to see you.
Yeah, it's great, and customers want to see us working together, and we're starting to, which is great.
Yep.
So Manoj, you're talking about teasing us last time around, talking about the Docker relationship and the integration, so I want to drill down on that here in this segment is, what are you guys doing with HP, and let's talk about that. I want to go a little bit deeper on some of the things you're doing, what's the development projects, and benefits to the customers.
Yeah, you know, we're finalizing an alliance agreement with them right now. We're working very closely with them internally on their use of Docker and adoption of it, so from an engineering perspective, we're working very closely together. The TS organization is going to support Docker on a global basis, so providing L1, L2 support for our product on the front end, which is what customers want.
Yep.
They want to leverage the same support, the great support that they get from HP. And then the ES group, you know, just thinking about how you approach DevOps, how you approach application migration into containers, you know, that thought leadership and services is going to help us a lot. And so across all the major segments of the new organization, we're going to be working well strongly together.
Manoj, talk about the composable synergy opportunity. I was saying to Dave earlier, I think the composable message, the synergy is going to be as big as converged infrastructure was.
Yeah.
I mean, well, is now, but when converged infrastructure started, people were like, what is that? That's just marketing by HP.
Yeah.
Turns out the whole world now is doing CI, now hyper-converged. Composable's on the next step. What's
Absolutely,
Docker
John.
Doing in Composable? What's the relationship? What are you guys, where are you putting them in?
Yeah, you know, John, as we talked, I think yesterday, you know, Composable, we think is going to be much bigger than even the Converged. And it grew out of the whole notion of the idea economy and how do you support that while you support traditional. You know, we believe Docker is a great example of something that powers the idea economy where people are trying to use technology to grow businesses. And that's, you know, that's the perfect marriage with our composable vision where we're, you know, trying to bring Docker, make it easier for enterprises to deploy Docker on premises, right? So developers are using it, they're using it in the public cloud, but then as enterprises look at standardizing on it, they're like, how do I make that easily deployed? So that's the integration. Docker is, you know, deeply integrated into the composable API and HPE Synergy. So
how deep? I mean, what's the relationship?
It's an API.
Joint engineering effort, or is it
a joint engineering effort. You know, our teams have jointly created a Docker driver that can actually talk Synergy and Composable. So directly at an API level, deploy a container onto Synergy, no virtualization or abstraction required, which gives it a lot of flexibility.
Almost cloud-like.
Hey, what does it look like?
Cloud native for bare metal.
Cloud native on bare metal. So that's exactly what we're trying to do.
And, that's awesome.
And that's, you know, so very exciting.
I wonder.
And by
if
the way, you know, just one more.
No, please,
HPIT is already using it. So we are the first internal customer. We're drinking our own champagne with this integration. And,
not,
you know,
Kool-Aid, it's champagne.
Champagne,
No,
Kool-Aid. It's better than dog food.
Kool-Aid injection, that's a Silicon Valley term.
There you go.
So I want to go back. So 2 years ago, I got a text from John Furrier saying, our friend, you know, Jerry Chen from Greylock's doing his first deal. Docker. I'm like, who's Docker? What do they do? He goes, containers. I'm like, wow, like you, Linux containers? What's the big deal? They've been around forever. So help people understand why it's such a big deal. Containers been around for a long time.
Yeah,
right?
You know, I think, you know, from the very beginning, what Solomon focused on, containers have been around for a while, you know that. What he did was he made them easily accessible for developers to use them and create containerized applications. So there's a reason there's been over 6 million downloads. And what we're seeing now is over the last 12 to 18 months, 24 months, more and more developers have been using it. And now what we're seeing is the large enterprises coming in saying, I've got to have a solution to be able to manage these containers at scale. And that's where relationships with HP become important, and that's where our development of our product line has become very, very important.
Well, Docker also, another thing I'd add to that, Solomon's awesome, and the thing that I recognize, small nuance, is that he nailed the open source component of it.
Absolutely.
And that really was the flywheel that got it going.
Yep.
And then everyone else said, hey, if we all do this, we can solve the interoperability problem, which total holy grail for the whole DevOps and infrastructure as code
and
paradigm.
I think perfectly timed and positioned.
Yeah. Really, timing
it
was perfect.
It was at a time where DevOps obviously was exploding. I believe it's the common denominator that really enables the agility and portability that we needed. And then everybody was thinking about a hybrid strategy, right? And the way you achieve hybrid is, you know, abstracting away those dependencies and making that container easily portable.
Right.
And most customers are looking to be cloud brokers. And they're looking for a way to get there.
And Manoj, the time from developers picking up on a new trend to going mainstream in the enterprise is compressing like crazy. I mean, you see, you saw it in big data, you're seeing it in DevOps, you're seeing it in containers. Why is that, and what does that mean for your business and how you guys partner?
Right, I mean, you know, I think one, you know, the whole open source movement and, you know, it's crowdsourced, community first, that has become the mantra, right? And when that happens, the developers inside the enterprise are part of that as much as people outside the enterprise.
They're not isolated developers.
They're not isolated developers, and they pull in the rest of the enterprise, right? So this is becoming a dev-centric world rather than, you know, what used to be, you know, very traditional IT processes. I think the combination of that and the combination of every enterprise, you know, figuring out, hey, there's a lot of disruptors out there. What are they doing? Well, they're leveraging some of these new technologies. Well, why don't we leverage them? So it's a perfect marriage of business needs and that ecosystem, right?
Well, at the time, the timing's perfect. I want to drill down on the innovation piece because I was talking with Mariana Tessel this morning, VP of Engineering, and I was commenting after our interview, yesterday I was telling them about our interview, which was I was so pumped for, and then I was joking with Dave yesterday, your infrastructure as code is a term we've been using for over 4 years now.
Yeah.
And the cloud native guys, the pioneers, that was the marching orders for DevOps. Obviously the early adopters was the cloud native guys. But now when you see going mainstream into traditional IT, it's hit the tipping point. So Roger, I got to ask you that, you know, Mariana, Ben, and the team at Docker, her joke was, things repeat themselves. We're seeing the same movie in the Valley again, which is early adopters crossing over to mainstream.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of experience in the Docker team that have been on teams that have crossed over.
Right.
You guys are crossing over in this moment, and you're basically bringing Docker for the cloud to bare metal, which basically makes the whole synergy thing rock and roll. I mean, that's, am I getting that right?
Yeah, you know, I think it's perfectly suited for the HP technology and what they're coming out with. What we're seeing in the last 3 to 4 months with the introduction of some of our new products on the operational side is there's been just a yearning for the operations team to have the right tools and security to run Docker containers.
Yep.
So we announced Tudum through our acquisition, which gives us a SaaS-based offering to be able to achieve that. And then we have the Universal Control Plane, which was Orca that we demoed back in June, and now we're baiting that as a public beta. To give you a perspective on how much demand there is, in the first 2 weeks since the early access and beta, over 3,000 companies have come in for requests for the code. Yeah. 2 weeks, right?
Yeah.
So what that says is the 6 million developers that are out there that are using Docker, there's pent-up demand for the operational tooling to be able to run this. And what inevitably most large account, Fortune 500 accounts ask for is, how do I work with a trusted partner like HP and Docker to go make this
It really is a win-win scenario. It's not a Barney deal, as we used to say in the old days.
Right.
You know, we love each other, you know, I love you, you love me. This is really a real strategic deal because you can bring the developers to HP, the DevOps, so that rises the tide for the whole synergy deal.
Right.
But also, it also gives the developers a touch point into a community of other developers.
Right.
So all the ITs that have skill gap issues and or these isolated development teams get huge lift.
Yeah. Right.
Recruiting, these guys get the access to the cloud paradigm faster.
Right.
Interesting deal. So I got to ask you, what is the hot thing right now with you guys? What's the, give us some details on where you guys are in the relationship, are the deals signed, are they coding, are customers getting the products? Give us the update.
So we have a couple of reference architectures that are live. I mean, we took, again, our internal champagne process and made that available to our customers as a first step. Hey, look, this is how we leveraged Docker and used it in a Fortune 50 company. in terms of its separation processes and some of the work we did there. So, you know, that started, you know, as some of the first things we're getting out there. There's, you know, you saw Martin announce yesterday the Secure Container OS. I mean, we're, you know, all in on this one, right? It's like, okay, Docker is a container. You know, we not only want to...
Did you use Secure Container OS in the split plan, or...?
It is used internally as part of some of our systems. We have not talked about it much, right? So, it's, you know, like Cloud System actually has the container OS embedded in it.
Okay.
So, now that's being made available specifically in a Docker context, and that's a great example, you know, so the Synergy API integration... the secure container OS, and you know, going back to Roger's point, right? Like the whole, how do you operationalize it? This is where our technical services team has been, you know, trained, ramped up.
Yeah.
They're bringing their ops expertise. They have been trained with the dev expertise,
yep.
And that becomes
it's
a perfect
top seller.
Bridge,
it's
right?
gonna be, so it's gonna like, be a
yeah,
good
I mean,
seller.
I think what's unique about this is, you know, eating your own dog food. I mean, HP is using the product. They're using the portfolio, and mm-hmm. I think that gives you unique credibility with customers when you walk in to say, we not only are selling you the product. We're using it ourselves to get operational efficiency right. with our developers and our DevOps processes internally. I think that's a big deal. I think, you know, we recently announced networking plugins and storage plugins. We're working with the HP team to ensure that that's done well and is a priority.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, across all segments, we're doing the right things.
Roger, how can you describe how your go-to-market is evolving? You started out with a grassroots effort with developers,
yeah.
and now you're sort of expanding your partnerships. How is that? Growing.
Yeah, you know, I think strategic alliances are really important for us in the Fortune 500, Fortune 1000, so we focused on those. We have very few of them. We're being very selective about how we do them. Microsoft, obviously, is one of them, and you saw announcements
yeah.
with HP yesterday or the day before related mm-hmm. to that, so that synergy is fantastic. We're doing a lot of work with Accenture right now, also a big partner of HP, so we like that. Obviously, we have other partners in the ecosystem that we're working with as well. You know,
you're an arms dealer.
Huh?
You're an arms dealer.
We're an arms dealer.
Yeah, but you're a selective arms dealer right now.
But,
you're not trying to get
a... But as a small startup, I mean, we have to be careful, right? We have,
yeah.
we have to place our bets. We have to ensure that the partnership is real.
Right.
And we have to have an engagement that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because, you know,
right.
having done this before,
yeah.
Trying to integrate yeah. to a rather a very, very large company,
yeah.
you have to be, you know, really selective about how you're going to bring your value proposition.
If you spread yourself too thin, you're going to be,
you're
not going to be
right.
effective at all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You've got to be focused.
But I don't see that here at all. Just here in Europe over the last 5 days, the number of manufacturing, financial services companies, government agencies in the UK that we're engaging with HP already, that's
right.
how you breed a successful partnership.
They're gonna, it's a win-win. You get access to their client base.
Right.
They want to get private clouds up and running
we
as seamless as possible.
We have deep expertise in the technology. They have the platform that integrates
okay.
well.
Right.
And customers want solutions, right?
Yeah, so I got to ask the question. So the developer's going to love this. I can see that.
Right.
And we'll have to dig into how it plays
yeah.
out. We'll get Brian Gracely on the case, and he'll give us 2 cents in there.
Sure.
But I got to ask about the user experience and the consumption side of this.
Yeah.
So the technology vector, totally great.
Mm-hmm.
Love the action. How does a customer consume this? Are they going to feel like the bare metal piece on the traditional IT will feel the same way as cloud? Is that the vision? Are you guys actually seeing that today?
Yeah.
What's the current reality and what's the preferred experience that you guys want to have happen?
Sure, I mean, I think customers want agility, right? And this whole notion of this idea economy, to fuel that, you need to be able to get to, try out your ideas and see if it doesn't work, iterate
fast. Will it be the same as cloud?
And exactly, right? That's what we want. So we want that cloud-like speed and agility. That's the integration that we have now enabled. You know, Docker wants to make this frictionless, right? The more components that you have in the stack and the dependencies with, multiple vendors,
mm-hmm.
there's going to be more friction. So now, we've removed any dependencies. It's Docker, it's HP, that's it. You know, you don't need anything else, including the OS with the secure OS container. That helps. Global reach, our services and support arm, being able to do the bridge from dev to DevOps and helping, rapid production. I think, those are some of the things that, we see happening right now as we talk about.
So that facilitates a true hybrid IT. I'm not crazy about this bimodal because it sort of creates stovepipes.
Right. Yeah.
You're talking about a different vision.
Exactly.
Bringing those two worlds together so they're seamless.
Yeah. They basically kill the bimodal.
And, you know, our product strategy is to do just that. Right. Yeah. We don't want our SaaS offering Tudum to be a separate and distinct product with a different user experience than the on-prem.
Right.
We're trying to converge those as best we can. Yeah. And
seamless.
That's why we're doing it. We want it to be seamless. So you should be able to have an operational control plane that sits on top of HP's hardware, that manages containers and seamlessly allows you to point to Azure or any other cloud provider and give you a hybrid experience natively using Docker's APIs and tools. I think before we came forward with this tool set on the operations side, you know, customers had to compromise. And the customers that I were talking to said, you know, PaaSes are okay, but how am I going to replicate that experience across cloud and become a broker?
Yeah.
And
this
is where having integrations with companies like HP and having the APIs exposed and used will enable that for
customers.
Well,
that's exactly the friction you're talking about. It's a hassle for the customer.
It is.
And so, like, that's why they were doing it. So if you could pull off that seamless experience, you'll be very successful, I think. I mean,
We're very excited. Our customers have, you know, reacted very positively.
Well, if you say it has to be true.
Of course.
It's set the cue.
Well, that's what I mean. That's why cloud's so good. I mean, but the private cloud market that these guys are building. I mean, we heard Bill Hill from the Cube here saying, "Hey, we're out of the public cloud," and for the reasons why. They're number one reseller of Red Hat, VMware. Why, you know, why do the public cloud? Be the private cloud guy.
Yeah, you know, the Fortune 1000 is very focused on not having another shadow IT experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Docker is growing so organically with developers that their greatest fear is not having an answer to those developers to be able to run this in a secure and reliable and seamless way. And this is the gap in the market today that we're trying to address.
Yeah. And we said on theCUBE, again, another thing that we were accurate on was Shadow IT, it was the R&D. It's now the product.
Yeah.
So it was basically in demand of how sucky IT was, basically.
Yeah, it was, because they were slow, right?
Yeah, I don't want it.
Shared services was slow, and they don't want that to be the perception as they move forward with this container technology.
It's a wake-up call.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And CEOs saying, okay, hey, figure this out. Let's get it together, because we have governance and security and compliance needs. So
absolutely.
It
builds a need for change. So,
all right, so give us the update on DockerCon Barcelona. What's new? What's going on back at the ranch? Are you traveling around the world now? Give us the update.
Traveling around the world, too much. My family misses me. I don't know if they watch theCUBE, but
they're up late. It's 3 a.m.
Yeah, exactly. You know, a lot of things. You know, we highlighted Swarm, right? Swarm was very, very well received. We showed that scaling to 1,000 nodes, 50,000 containers, live in the event, despite some networking problems that we might have had in Barcelona. That was great. You know, Docker Trusted Registry 1.4 has all the capabilities that our customers have been asking for. It's a key component of the DevOps lifecycle. It integrates Docker Content Trust, which is a very, very big deal. Security and image signings is really important in the DevOps process.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the control planes, right? Both Tudum and the Universal Control Plane that give you the SaaS offering and the on-prem offering to manage these end-to-end are really important.
If I had a dime for every question I heard another analyst and press person ask Docker, I'd be a millionaire, but I'm not going to ask how you make money question, because you know, I talk to Jerry Chen all the time, that's going to come downstream. You got tons of funding, so you guys are solid on the burn rate, you're not going to run out of cash.
No.
But business model still is open, it's free, Docker is free.
Oh no, I mean, so we have a subscription offering that we have launched. We are starting to sign very real customers.
Okay.
And we'll talk more about those over the next few months, and they'll be highly referenceable.
So you differentiate on services?
We're differentiated on services. We're differentiated on the code, right? Yeah. I mean, if you want, Docker Trusted Registry has a lot of capabilities and integration and software engineering that is built around the open source registry, like groups and delete. The ability to manage signings and see that in it and integrate it seamlessly and testing on top of different OSs, it's very, very important. And now, of course, the operational control plane software gives us a suite of products. We've been talking about a platform for a long time. We're now close to having that and we're starting to deliver it to customers. And what we're seeing by the inbound, just in the last 2 or 3 weeks, as I said, over 3,000 inbounds to use this software in the first 2 weeks. This is for real.
And sounds we're very like Cloudera. Right. Huh? Sounds like a little bit like Cloudera.
Yeah, well.
For big data. Yeah. Greylock, well, Cloudera.
No, well, but so it's a SaaS model, though. You're leading with a SaaS model, right?
Well, we have an on-prem model and we have a SaaS model. We have two separate offerings, right? So we have, you know, hundreds of thousands of users in Docker Hub. They're using us for automated builds. They're using us for private repositories to store their images. Typically, they're smaller companies or DevOps type organizations within larger companies. And now with Tudum, we give them the ability to manage and deploy those anywhere they want with a single plane of glass.
They can choose.
And now we take that same concept and put it on-prem with the Docker Trusted Registry and the Universal Control Plane. You add trust on top of that, and you can provide the backbone of a hybrid cloud implementation for any customer in the world.
Right. Yeah, I mean, then there's so much more headroom beyond that as you get growth. I mean, it's the classic problem of the critical mass flywheel versus the when you start monetizing. So you guys are starting to monetize.
Yes.
Not too aggressively, though. I mean, you're going to make money. The board's happy. They're seeing some revenue coming in. But the upside's still way down, potentially down the road, too. I mean, huge upside.
And we'll accelerate that as quickly as we can.
Certainly, HP will help you on a global scale.
And they will. I mean, you know, and you know, what's amazing to me is, you know, we have large multinationals in Europe that are calling us that we've never spoken to before. Some of the largest automobile manufacturers in Germany.
Yeah.
Some of the largest software providers in Germany.
Yeah.
Coming in and saying, we are going to deploy 8,000 to 10,000 nodes of Docker to run our hosted service. Tell us about your supported offerings. We want the trusted registry. We want the control plane. And when they do that, they typically come in and say, we're working with a company like HP. We're working with a company like Accenture. We're also thinking not only about Linux workloads, but Windows workloads. And how are we going to manage all of that in a seamless way?
Manoj, final question. What he just said is amazing.
Yeah.
That puts pressure back on HP.
Right.
You've got to stand up bare metal. So,
yeah.
Sounds easy in cloud. Yeah. Little push a button, things are happening.
And manage.
How are you standing up
the
infrastructure
at
HP? What's the plan there? Composable all the way? When those guys call and say 8,000 nodes, I'd say, okay, I got 8,000 clusters, I got more servers coming out.
Look,
more.
It is, you know, the foundation of it is our software we talked about, OneView, right? So that's the integration point that works on our converged infrastructure, our cloud system product, you know, just our private cloud, our hyper-converged, and Synergy, it's built in. Right? So it's like a perfect marriage. Like the Synergy was being built as Docker was growing, and right now, from our perspective, you know, it's a fantastic match. Docker was a founding member, one of the founding members of the Composable ecosystem. So there,
how many people in the ecosystem right now?
There's, you know, about a dozen.
Composable ecosystem.
Uh huh. Yep.
Okay. Awesome.
Right?
Manoj, thank you very much, Roger. Great to see you from Docker. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We're big fans of Docker, as you know. Really think you guys have done amazing industry work. The solidarity, the community.
Yeah.
You guys hit a home run. Best of continued success.
Thank you.
And say hello to everyone back at the ranch. We're here inside theCUBE at HP Discover in Europe, and we're in London live with here Docker and HP Composable Infrastructure as part of the new Synergy. We'll be right back with more after this short break.